Hello everybody and welcome to the Creatrix YouTube channel. I welcome you all in a fresh session of analog electronics. And my dear friends, when I say we are going to learn analog electronics from the very basic, I mean it. We will be learning from the very, very basic level to the very advanced level along with a lots and lots of questions. So before we do that, let me first introduce myself for my friend who is meeting me for the first time. My dear friends, my name is Ankit Goyal. I got AIR1 twice in GATE in 2014 and 2018. I was awarded the President of India Gold Medal in the year 2013 when I graduated from IIT Indore. Till date, I have trained more than 1 lakh students in the online and the offline classes and presently working as a director at an academy for GATE department. But my dear friends, the reason behind this series is because of the huge demand of analog electronics. And the belief that whenever you ask for anything, we are there to deliver. Yes, my dear friends, we are here for you. We are here delivering for you. And when we say it, we'll support you to the very, very fullest level. And this series will help you crack GATE with the top rank. It will enable EC student to get 12 out of 12 and 5 out of 5 for electrical students. So my dear friends, if you want to learn with us live, then you can join an academy using the code ANKITASE to get an immediate 10% discount. And not only my dear friend 10% discount, it also brings you under my guidance so that I can help you do something that I have done. I can at least take you near to this goal. Okay. So if you also dream the same thing, then join me in this journey on an academy subscription using the code ANKITASE. Now, my dear friend, if you like the content that I deliver, you can watch more of my free videos on this URL, tinyurl.com/ankitase. Here you will find all my videos arranged subject-wise, chapter-wise, and you will find great content for free. And you are definitely going to love it. You are definitely going to enjoy. It not only includes conceptual videos, but it also includes problem-solving sessions. So just visit this once and you will fall in love with this URL. Don't forget it. It is a lifeline for you. And if you love the content that we are delivering on YouTube, we have created the first ever video book for you guys, where you will find all the videos along with all the notes that we provide arranged subject-wise, chapter-wise. So now, my dear friends, your dreams are no longer dreams. They are becoming a reality because you are getting a top quality course, well arranged, well structured, and that too for free. So what can be better than that? Nothing, my dear friends. So we have empowered the dreams of those who earlier used to think that only the person with a huge amount of money can crack GATE with a top rank. No, my dear friends, that is not the case. Even you can do it. But yes, just you need to believe in yourself and visit this link. But remember, this is a case sensitive link, so write this in uppercase. Other than that, if you join plus subscription, you get all the top educators like me teaching you live in daily lectures, along with providing you daily practice paper, weekly quiz, test series, previous year question, practice question, crash course, rank improvement batch, and most importantly, clearing your each and every doubt. So if you join plus subscription, it is an entire world inside it. So you don't have to look outside. Once you enter plus, every need of yours will be taken care of and we will make your journey as smooth as possible towards that destination of getting under 100, under 10 rank. Believe me, my friend, you leave that strategy part to us. You leave the content part to us. You just work hard and we will make sure that you obtain the top rank in GATE and ESE. And Iconic is a big brother of Plus. Yes, this is a little brother. So Iconic gives you everything that the Plus subscription gives, along with much more. The major part of Iconic is this personal coach, a person dedicated to you on a daily basis to get you the top rank, guiding you, getting your schedule designed, making your strategy. Everything that you need to get the top rank is being done by this personal coach. He'll also create a study planner for you, which you can follow blindly and reach your destination with utmost ease. They will be analyzing your test result and tell you where you are lacking, how you can improve. So that way, my dear friend, everybody else will get a standard analysis, but you will get an analysis just tailor-made for you. Along with it, we have included study material additionally, theory and question bank, and soon we'll be introducing interview guidance into this. So this will become a complete package for a student who wants to take that journey from being an average student to sitting into a PSU or a M.Tech seat. So for them, this journey will be just like driving a Lamborghini to work. So that sort of a experience, that sort of a royal experience we are going to give you. So let's move on to the lecture. And if you want to join an academy, just make sure you use the code ANKITESE to get my guidance as well as to get 10% over and above whatever an academy offers you. So now let's move on to the lecture, dear friends, and let's see what we have in store for you.
Hi guys, in the previous video I told you about the different types of amplifier that are present, like voltage amplifier, current amplifier, transconductance amplifier and the transresistance amplifier. And we saw some problems based on such kind of amplifiers. From this lecture onwards, we'll be starting our study of operational amplifier or op-amp. So we'll be directly diving into the topic and understand how op-amp is constructed and how the circuit based on op-amp will work. Okay. So the first thing that we'll be understanding in this lecture is the concept of op-amp, how this op-amp works. So first of all, op-amp has two high impedance inputs. High impedance inputs. And how many inputs are there? Two inputs. And one output port. Okay. So there are two high impedance input and there is one output terminal. Now due to this high impedance input, if the input impedance is high, the input current is approximately zero. That means the current input to op-amp, current input to op-amp is very small. Is it fine? Now, if you see the model of this amplifier, the first input we are calling it as the non-inverting input. It is marked with a terminal plus. The second input is called as the inverting input. It is marked with a polarity minus. And this op-amp will always amplify the difference between the two inputs. So how do we take the difference? Vd is written as V in 2 minus V in 1. Or simply V2 minus V1. That is the difference voltage. Always remember, this Vd is the difference of the voltage between non-inverting input and the inverting input. So it is always non-inverting input minus inverting input. Okay, it is the difference of these two voltages. Now see, at the output side, we will show a dependent voltage source. This is a dependent voltage source. What is the value of this voltage source? It is A times V2 minus V1. That is A times Vd. So the input side we are taking voltage and the output side also we are taking voltage. So what kind of amplifier it is? It is a voltage amplifier. Remember, in the last video I told you about four types of amplifier. Out of that, which category is best suited to op-amp? It is a voltage amplifier because at the input side also we are taking voltage and at the output side also we are taking the voltage. Now this A is called as open loop gain. It is called as open loop gain of op-amp. And as I told you in the previous video, this gain is very high. It is approximately 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 5. This gain is very high. This voltage source is connected in series with the output resistance that is represented as Z out. And at the input side, we have shown input resistance as Z in. Okay. Then there are two more terminals. One is to provide positive supply voltage and other is to supply negative supply voltage. This is your DC voltage or you can say DC biasing. We very well know in BJT and MOSFET, whenever we want to operate it as an amplifier, we first have to provide DC biasing and then we will provide the AC signal. So that AC signal is connected at these two input terminal Vin1 and Vin2, and DC biasing is connected at plus V supply and minus V supply. Why this DC biasing is required? Remember I told you in amplifier, what an amplifier does is it absorbs the power from the DC supply and then injects this power in the AC signal in order to increase the amplitude of the AC signal. So AC signal is amplified using the power that is absorbed from the DC supply. So that is the basic working of any amplifier. And remember, op amp is a voltage amplifier which has two inputs. One is called as the non-inverting input, other is called as the inverting input. Why are they are called so? We will understand later on in the next video. But in this one, always remember there are two inputs, non-inverting and inverting, and there is one output. Two terminals are reserved for the supply, plus V supply and minus V supply, and one port is reserved as a ground. This is also one port. So basically in op-amp, the commonly used IC is IC741, which is a 8 terminal IC, out of which 3 are the most important terminals, 2 for the input and 1 for the output. Then 2 are reserved for supply, 1 for ground. Okay, that way overall there are 8 terminals. So whenever you see this number IC741, understand that it is talking about your op amp. Next, if you understand the block diagram of an amplifier, first of all it has two inputs, non-inverting input and the inverting input. Then what is this input stage? This input stage is basically a differential amplifier. What kind of differential amplifier? Dual input, balanced output, differential amplifier. Balanced output means, see, in differential amplifier we have two inputs like this. These are the two inputs. Then the output is taken from collector. If you use both the collector terminals and mark V0 as like this, then it is called as balanced output. If you take only one output terminal and consider the voltage with respect to ground like this, then it is called as unbalanced output. So if only one input one output terminal is used, unbalanced output. If both output terminals are used, it is called as balanced output. Okay. Now, why is this input stage important? It establishes the input resistance of op-amp. Remember this thing when we talk about multiple stages. This is multiple stage, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 and stage 4. So, it is a multi-stage amplifier. There are multiple stages. Whenever we talk about multi-stage amplifier, the input resistance is always governed by the first stage and output resistance is always governed by the last stage. So that is why the first stage is very important, because it establishes the input resistance of the op-amp. Next thing, as I told in the previous video, op-amp is a direct coupled amplifier. What I meant by direct coupled amplifier? That the output of one stage, if you see, is directly connected to the input of the second stage. There are no components connected between the two stages. So it is a direct coupled amplifier. Okay. Next stage is your intermediate stage. This intermediate stage is also a differential amplifier, but it is dual input, unbalanced output. Now if you see, due to unbalanced output, there is only one output line shown. From the first one, if you see, there are two output terminals, because I told in balanced output we have to take two terminals at the output. But here intermediate stage is unbalanced output, so there is only one terminal. So intermediate stage is also a differential amplifier, and these two stages will establish gain of amplifier. Majorly, the gain of this op-amp will depend on the first two stages, input stage and the intermediate stage. Is my point clear to you? Then if you see the third stage is a level shifting circuit. Now those of you who have studied multi-stage amplifier are very well aware of the disadvantage of direct coupling. I told in direct coupling what happens, since we are directly connecting the output of the first stage to the input of the second stage, you are directly connecting. There is no component involved. That means the signal that will go from one stage to the other will consist of DC as well as AC signal. If you wanted to stop the DC signal, you could have used capacitor, because capacitor will work as open circuit for the DC signal. That means if we use a coupling capacitor like we were using in BJT, then what will happen? For DC, this capacitor will be open. So DC signal will not go from one stage to the other. But since we are using direct coupling, in direct coupling, the signal passing from the one stage to the other stage will consist of DC as well as AC. Now, what will happen? I'll tell you the working of level translator later on. First, understand what will happen. The Q point will shift. Suppose if I talk about BJT, how was the output characteristic looking like? We were showing output characteristics like this. Okay. We wanted BJT to operate in the active region. How we were finding the Q point? By taking the intersection of the load line with the characteristics. So see, this region was saturation, this was active, and this was cutoff. Okay, this was cutoff. Now this is BJT biased in the active region, these two points. The second and the third point show that BJT is biased in the active region. 2 and 3 represent active region. But now, due to DC signal passing from one stage to the next, if DC passes from one stage to the other, then it will lead to shifting of Q point. The Q point of every stage will not be identical, because we are passing the DC signal from one stage to the other. So what will happen if DC passes? The output DC of first stage will act as the input. And if the input of the second stage is changing, its Q point will also change. Is my point clear to you? What is happening when DC signal is passing from first stage to the next? That DC signal will be used to decide the Q point of the second stage, and that is why it may happen that Q point is not lying in the active region. If Q point does not lie in the active region, BJT will not work as an amplifier. Either it will work as a switch, okay, because in saturation and cutoff, BJT works as a switch. Now, if it works as a switch, it will produce distortion in the waveform. Because an amplifier, what does an amplifier do? An amplifier increases the amplitude, but it never changes the shape of the waveform. But if your BJT enters the cutoff or the saturation region, then basically the shape of the waveform will change, which is undesirable. Okay, so we don't want the cue point to change. That is why we must bring back the DC signal to zero. So DC signal should be brought back. Should be brought back to zero. And that is the working of your level translator. Now suppose the output of first stage is like this. Some DC plus AC. In the second stage, what happens? This DC level increases. So if this DC level increases by a large amount, it may so happen that the shape of the waveform may get distorted like this. Suppose the shape becomes like half wave rectifier, then that is undesirable. So what we want is to bring back the DC level to zero. If DC level becomes zero, the waveform will be centered about time axis. And that is why this level translator is being used. Are you getting my point? The first stage is a dual input balanced output amplifier. The second stage is dual input unbalanced output differential amplifier. Okay, but since they are directly coupled, the cue point will move from the active region. It can either move to saturation or it can move to cutoff. In both the cases, the waveform will be distorted and that property is undesirable. So we have to bring back the DC level to zero, which is being done by the third stage or level translator. Now, how we are using level translator? See, this is the first implementation of a level translator. So here what we have done is we have used a BJT with dual supply bias. Dual supply bias. Now what we do is we bias this BJT in such a way that we obtain 0 volt here. How we are obtaining 0 volt? By using a potential divider. This R1 and R2 circuit is a potential divider. So by the use of a potential divider network, we are obtaining 0 volt DC at this terminal. So for that we are using dual supply biasing, because if it was ground not dual supply, then this potential cannot be 0. For this potential to be 0, we have to use a negative voltage at the ammeter terminal. That is the first implementation. Otherwise, we can also use, this was discussed in diode compensation. Those of you who have taken ESE lectures might have seen this circuit before when we talked about diode compensation. Okay. And this is your current mirror. So there are different techniques of biasing the BJT, either using current mirror, diode compensation or potential divider network. So we have seen three types of biasing here: potential divider, but where? At ammeter. It is not voltage divider biasing, because there we were using voltage divider network at the base. But now we are using voltage divider at ammeter. The second one we have seen for diode compensation. And the third one is for current mirror. So we are using different techniques to bias the BJT. But what we want at the output terminal, the DC level must be zero. Okay. So it will cancel the shifting that has been obtained in the DC signal. That is the purpose of level translator. And the final stage which we were mentioning as the output stage, that output stage is a push pull complementary amplifier. Okay, this we haven't studied so far. It is a part of power amplifiers, but power amplifiers is not in gate course. So it is nothing but a power amplifier. And why it is used? It increases the swing of output voltage. Okay, that is the maximum value that the output voltage can have will be increased by this output stage. So it will increase the ability of the output voltage to swing to a higher level. That is, higher level voltages will be allowed by the use of the final stage. Is it fine? So these are the four stages of an op amp. You have to remember them verbally. Don't get too much into depth of these four stages. Just remember the name: input stage, dual input balanced output, intermediate stage, dual input unbalanced output, level translator to bring the DC level to zero, then fourth stage, push-pull complementary amplifier, which is used to increase the swing of the output voltage. Now if we show this entire circuit, you can see this. This is the first stage. See, there is dual biasing, plus VCC and minus VEE. When I showed you the circuit of op-amp, there also I told you there are two supplies, plus V supply and minus V supply. And those voltages are written here as plus VCC and minus VEE. So this first stage is a dual input. See, there are two inputs at the two base of BJT and balanced output. How balanced output? See, output is being taken from this terminal as well as output is being taken from the second terminal. Then in the next one, there are two inputs. These are the two inputs. But output is taken from only one collector. Inputs are two, but output is only one. So this is dual input unbalanced output. Then this third stage is a level translator, and this is a push-pull complementary amplifier. So that is how the four stages of op-amp are connected together. It can be made using BJT or it can be made using MOSFET also, okay? But this kind of circuit an op-amp possesses. You don't have to, again I am saying, you don't have to memorize the entire circuit. Just remember the name of the stages and what kind of amplifier is being used in each stage. Now let us focus our attention on treating op-amp as a black box. So how we will treat it as a black box? It will be represented as a triangle. We will show two inputs inside it and one output. These two inputs represent, the first one is your non-inverting input. This is non-inverting and this one is inverting. How to identify? Non-inverting input is marked with a plus sign and inverting input is marked with a minus sign. Suppose it is V1, suppose this is V2. Don't memorize V1 and V2, just remember inverting and non-inverting input. How you will write V0? V0 is simply A times the difference. Difference is always non-inverting minus inverting. This can also be represented like this. First, we will take the difference V1, V2 plus minus. Then their difference will be passed through a amplifier having a gain A. We will get V0. So basically, op-amp is nothing but it is a combination of a subtractor and a gain. The subtractor will give the difference of the voltages V1 minus V2. So V0 will be A times V1 minus V2. Okay. So here we are showing the simplistic mathematical model of op-amp. Mathematical model means we are just providing the relation between the input and the output voltages. We are not getting into the internal construction of this op-amp. Internally, how did we show the op-amp? We showed op-amp like this. At the input terminal, plus minus, we have input resistance Rn. Then there is a dependent voltage source, A into Vd, and output resistance R0. And this entire box is shown in a triangle type of structure like this. Okay, that is the internal circuitry of op-amp. This is your V1, this is your V2, and this voltage is your Vd. That is the difference voltage. Now the current here is called as Ip, the current here In, the current here I0. Never ever think that Ip plus In plus I0 will be zero. No, it is never true. Okay, the sum of the currents may or may not be zero. There is no such necessary condition. Secondly, I0 can be greater than zero or I0 can be less than zero. What does it mean? Op-amp can supply the current as well as op-amp can absorb the current. It is not necessary that op-amp will always supply the current, or we can say it can act as a source of current, or it can act as a sink of current. Sink means absorbing, source means supplying. Okay, both the possibilities are always there. Is it fine? So remember, the input currents are Ip and In, and the output current is I0, and their sum may or may not be zero. Now when we talk about ideal and practical op-amp, in ideal op-amp what happens? Understand the properties of this ideal op-amp. In ideal op-amp, this Ip and In both are zero. That is, no current enters op-amp. Why I am saying this? Remember, in the last lecture we talked about voltage amplifier. In voltage amplifier, what did I tell you? Input resistance is high and output resistance is low. This I told. Now in this kind of amplifier, ideally what should happen? That Rn tends to infinity and R0 tends to zero. That is the ideal case. If this input resistance tends to infinity, it will act as open circuit. If it is open circuit, what will be the currents? The currents will be zero. So ideal op-amp is nothing but it is an ideal amplifier or ideal voltage amplifier. So ideal op-amp is an ideal voltage amplifier, or it can also be called as ideal voltage controlled voltage source. Also, in an ideal op-amp, the open loop gain is infinite. Okay, ideal op-amp does not have a finite value of gain. It will always have a infinite value of gain. So how you will show an ideal op-amp? The input resistance is infinite, so it will be open circuited. Then at the output side, we will have a voltage source AVD, and then we will have output resistance will be zero. So it will be like this, V0, and we will show a triangle like this in order to show that it is a op-amp. Okay, so that is the circuit of an ideal op-amp. Is it fine? For practical op-amp, what will happen? For practical, the gain A will be finite, Rn and R0 will also be finite and non-zero. If input resistance is finite, Ip and In are not equal to zero. They will have certain finite value. So remember, ideal op-amp is nothing but an ideal voltage amplifier or ideal voltage controlled voltage source. Next, if we talk about the transfer characteristics of op-amp, transfer characteristic means the curve that is plotted between the output and the input voltage. Now, one thing that you have to remember in case of op-amp is that V0 can never exceed supply voltage. That is, we showed two supplies, minus VEE and VCC. It can be equal to them, but it cannot exceed them. So that is why the transfer characteristic cannot be completely linear. So when we are plotting the transfer characteristics, we will plot the graph between V0 and VD. VD was V1 minus V2. Now, we always write like this, V0 is AVD. So, it is a linear relation. So, this graph will be linear, but it will have a high slope because the gain is very high. But as soon as you reach VCC or minus VEE, you cannot go beyond, so output will saturate. And what will be the x-axis intercept of this curve? This x-axis intercept will be VCC by A. This will be minus VEE by A. Because we know V0 is VCC, so how you will find VD? VD is simply V0 by A. Now if this A is high, approximately 10 to the power 5, then this value is very small. And this value is also very small. So we will say that the linear region of op-amp transfer characteristic is very small. It is not linear in a large range. Okay. So it has a very small linear region. And that is undesirable. Why it is undesirable? Because if you apply even 1 millivolt, it will go into saturation. This is called as your saturation. So we don't want the amplifier to saturate. We always want amplifier to give an output proportional to the input. That is the basic purpose of amplifier. So if it is saturating, then it is undesirable for us. And that we don't want that to happen. So we have to increase this linear region, and later on I will tell you, by applying feedback, we will try to increase this linear range. But no matter whether feedback is connected or not, remember one golden rule, V0 cannot exceed the supply voltage. No matter what amplifier you construct, what components you are connecting, it cannot exceed the supply voltage. Okay? So if I summarize, what you have to remember in this video, you have to remember that the first stage of an op-amp is input stage. What is this stage? Dual input, balanced output, differential amplifier. The second one is intermediate stage. It is dual input but unbalanced output. Third is level translator. What does it do? It makes DC level equal to zero. Why does DC level shift? Because we are making use of direct coupling. The last stage is your output stage. What is this output stage? Push pull complementary amplifier. Okay. The second thing that I told you is, in an ideal op-amp, that you have to remember, the input currents are zero. Okay. R0 is zero. Input resistance tends to infinity. Open loop gain tends to infinity. That is the case of ideal op-amp. The thirdly, V0 can never exceed supply voltage. Okay. The fourth that I told you is linear region of op-amp is small. out of this, the two rules that we will use in problem solving is this one and this one. These two are very important when solving the problems based on op-amp, as you will come to know later on. Okay, so this is all from this video. In the next one, we'll study about open loop applications of op-amp. Thank you.
For 12 months, the pricing is 3250, but if you apply the code AnkitESE, it becomes 27225. For 18 months, it will be 34650, and for 24 months, 39600. Believe me, my dear friend, this is the most affordable pricing, and the longer duration subscriptions are more cost effective as compared to shorter duration. Like here, it will cost you 1650 per month. Okay, this will be 2000 per month approx. This will be around 2250 per month. Then if you go for Iconic for 12 months, it is 5250 with code AnkitESE, it becomes 45225. And 2 year subscription becomes 66600. So the choice is your, but take a longer duration subscription for more cost effective solution, and to give gate and ESE at least 2 times, so that if you once crack gate, in the next attempt you can even get ESE. And other than that, my friends, you can download the Unacademy learning app right now, because there we provide live classes for free, test series and live quizzes for free. And once you download it, make sure that you follow this profile. This is my profile, so that whenever I come live, you will get the notification. And this is the Telegram channel for our team. Here you will find all the lecture links, all the lecture files, and all the links for the special classes. Other than that, my friend, my personal Telegram channel also you can join, t.me/gateair1. Here you can get in touch with me, and we can take this journey together. Okay. Other than that, we have other YouTube channels like Mechanical, Civil, and Telugu. JE channel, Computer Science, Gate Question, and Electrical Junction, Paathshala, and GS Terminal. Electrical Junction contains short videos of great concepts. Paathshala provides you animated content. JE preparation can be done through these two channels, Unacademy SSC JE and GS Terminal. And you can refer the other channels to the other friends in respective branches, so that they can also be benefited. At last, I would like to say, please share, like, and subscribe to this channel. Subscribe to this channel, and not only subscribe, press the bell icon so that you get notified whenever a new video comes. And share this videos among all your college group, among all your friends, so that we can create the first ever revolution of free education in field of GATE and ESE. Thank you to everybody for dedicating time to watching this video. Please move on to the next one as well, and take the benefit of all the free content that we are providing. And in case you have completed the series, do make sure you watch the other subjects available on this channel. Thank you.